So when it comes to casting the Doctor, let's say in this scenario we're going for the 14th Doctor, I would like to know, and I want to read the room on the chat for this, I want to know, for the 14th Doctor, should you be considered for the role if you are not a fan of the show? Like, should you be a fan of the show if you are going to be cast as the next Doctor? Is that prerequisite, like, necessary? Does that need to happen? And I want to get your folks' opinion on this. I want to see the chat. I want to know what the situation is. You asked, like, three questions there. That's because that's my problem for you folks to solve, okay? Because this seems like a discussion that seems to come up every so often in the discourse every so often. And I kind of wanted to sort of, like, make my thoughts on it known. Just sort of, like, bring a new aspect to the conversation, basically. When it comes to the 14th Doctor, shall we say, in this scenario, whether or not they're a fan, I only see this question posed, I only see this restriction imposed in these discussions when talking about Jodie Whittaker as the Doctor. I don't see, personally, any other context in which this conversation is had. And I feel like that is part of the problem. When it comes to who should play the Doctor, firstly, we need to kind of define the word fan. Because, for example, Patrick Troughton, I don't believe was a fan of Doctor Who when he took on the role in 1966. However, Doctor Who was so widespread, was so prominent due to things like, you know, Dalek mania. You know, it was omnipresent culturally in England in the mid-1960s. If you call him a fan, is it to do with the fact that he just knows about Doctor Who iconography? Does he know about the Daleks? Has he watched a couple of episodes? Because you kind of have to define fan in this context. When it comes to, for example, Jodie Whittaker, she was not an avid watcher of Doctor Who. She didn't watch every single episode, but she knew many people who worked in the industry who worked in Doctor Who, and she would watch those episodes, notably David Tennant. I think she watched a lot of David Tennant. Is she a fan by those definitions? Do you need to have a Twitter account and talk about Doctor Who all day? Do you need to have a Doctor Who live stream to be perceived as a fan? Or can you just enjoy it casually? So firstly, in my opinion, the whole premise of the conversation, whether or not someone should be a fan of the show in order to be cast as the Doctor, it feels like you're already dealing with a lot of variables and a very arbitrary standard, which is going to be based on who is asking the question. So when it comes to should you be a fan, let's talk about doctors who were not fans when they took on the role. Like I said, Patrick Troughton, he wasn't really an avid watcher of Doctor Who, but he took on the role. I don't believe John Pertwee was a fan of the show. He was aware of it, but as far as I'm aware, John Pertwee mainly took on the role of the Doctor because he was able to wear whatever outfits he wanted. He was able to wear whatever clothes and capes and costumes he wanted and do his own stunts. I think that was one main reason that John Pertwee decided to become the Doctor. I don't know about Tom Baker, there's conflicting stories about that. I think Colin Baker was the first out-and-out fan of the show to become the Doctor, but then the show with him did go into a decline, not because of Colin Baker, but we'll get to that in a moment, in terms of someone who was a fan of the show became the Doctor, and then look what happened, he ruined it. Like, I think you could, if you wanted to be bad faith about it, you could make that argument, but you're not going to see that argument made for arbitrary reasons. But when it comes to other actors who were not fans, Sylvester McCoy was not a fan of Doctor Who before taking the role. It was interesting watching the season 24 behind the scenes interviews. Like, there's the In Conversation with him, there's the behind the scenes features for season 24, where Sylvester McCoy says that he didn't watch Doctor Who before taking on the role. He was in the theatre on Saturday nights, primarily when Doctor Who would be on TV. He has a few memories of Patrick Troughton and the Daleks in black and white in the 1960s, but that was kind of the beginning and the end of his investment in the show. Yet you watch the audition tape of Sylvester McCoy. Obviously, he was helped by Andrew Carmel, John Nathan Turner, before he did the audition. But you see that audition, and even though he's not a fan of the show, the Seventh Doctor, the Doctor, is right there. It was terrific.
You know, I've spent seven lifetimes battling evil, and just when I think I've got my hands on it, well, you know what it's like, wrestling with smoke.
And Doctor Who's Magical Entertainment, Colin Baker was in Doctor Who before playing the Doctor. There we go. That's a super fan. He was in the Capaldi as well. He was a super fan. He was in the show. Then he became the Doctor. Aidan Woodhead says, I love how the chat has exploded with opinions on this question, because I think fundamentally it is an interesting question to have. I just think that the ones who mainly bring this up are not having it in good faith. Because when we talk about, like, Jodie Whittaker is a bad Doctor. Why? Well, she wasn't a fan of the show, and I think you should be a fan of the show, and you should respect the canon and respect everything that came before you. And it's like, okay, I disagree with that perspective, but, you know, what about people like Christopher Eccleston, who were not fans of the show? In fact, in an interview, he said that, you know, he was out playing when Doctor Who was on. He was outside with all the other cool kids, while all the nerds stayed indoors and watched Doctor Who.
No, I wasn't a fan as a child, no. I was playing out when Doctor Who was on as a child.
So when it comes to other actors who have played the Doctor in the modern variants of the show, like the 10th Doctor, David Tennant, was a massive super fan. Peter Capaldi was a massive super fan. I believe Capaldi was actually the, like, wasn't he the head of a appreciation society? He was like the head of a fan club in his area in Scotland. He was like the chair. He was the head of that fan club. So, yeah, it's great to have super fans play the show, but then you also get the polar opposite of that.
To be quite honest, I didn't realise how big Doctor Who was. I thought it was a cult.
And you also get actors like Matt Smith, where he says that he accepted the role, having, like, never watched Doctor Who, he was never really into it, and then to research the role, he watched The Tomb of the Cybermen for Patrick Troughton. So before he took on the role, he was not a fan of Doctor Who, and then he grew to really appreciate and love Patrick Troughton's interpretation of the role and the character. But then when it comes to, you know, Jodie Whittaker should have, like, researched the role. She should have looked at the history of the show and things like that. It all depends on your own processes. And I think whoever has these conversations to kind of, like, spite Jodie Whittaker, to basically say, you know, she should have researched the role. She should have done this. She should have done that. I think that many of these people having this conversation forget that actors are people. Like, I know that sounds like such a big simplification, but I do genuinely think that that sometimes happens with these conversations, because Jodie Whittaker is, at the end of the day, and all doctors, all actors are doing a job, and it's such a subjective, like, way on that, what your own processes are. Like, maybe, hypothetically, Jodie Whittaker did not watch other older variants of The Doctor because she herself did not want to be influenced. Maybe when you have a show with, like, over 55 years of history, you know, when she took on the role, and so many different incarnations, and so many of them conflict with each other as well, like 5 and 6, you watch them on TV, those are diametrically opposed, deliberately diametrically opposed takes on the character. And if you're not big into the show, or if you have not embraced the lore, then it's a case of, like, what do you do? What direction do you take? What is the right way to do it? I think if you were to take on the role and you've got 60 years of history behind you, like, it could be a very, like, daunting prospect. It could be intimidating as an actor, as a performer, where you want to make your stamp on the show. I don't think that Jodie Whittaker should be bound by what has come before her when it comes to her interpretation of the show. And I also think a lot of it does go into how Chris Chibnall wanted the 13th Doctor to be characterised and the conditions of her hiring. I understand that Chris Chibnall, I think, told Jodie Whittaker to not watch, you know, to not watch older episodes or to not watch classic Doctors and to not really look at what came before. And that is still, you may disagree with that creative process, but it is still a creative process. It's still a case of finding your own way, finding your own path to a character that you will put your own stamp on. If you were to watch loads of classic Doctor Who, you could easily fall into the trap of just imitating classic Doctor Who or imitating classic Doctors. This actually became a bit of a criticism of Jodie Whittaker, where people were saying that she was just doing a David Tennant impression. Like, okay, so by your own metric, you wanted her to have watched and researched prior incarnations, but then when she, in your opinion, I disagree, but in your opinion, does an impression of a classic Doctor, a well-beloved classic Doctor, 10 is like, what is just as iconic and recognisable in the role as Tom Baker. But then when she does that, in your opinion, that's a detriment. Like, I understand that there are complexities to this. I understand that there's a lot going on in terms of the creative processes. But when you say Jodie Whittaker's a bad Doctor and she should have researched the role, it's a whole, like, Pandora's box of discussion. And because you're having this conversation in bad faith predominantly, I don't mean you, chat, I mean this hypothetical person who, you know, kind of starts discourse like this, you kind of know that it's being had in bad faith. An actor's process is so personal and it is so completely down to them that I think if Jodie Whittaker, whether or not she was a fan or wasn't a fan, I think when she is cast as the Doctor, when she was cast as the Doctor, she should do whatever on earth makes her comfortable. And I think that it is not disrespectful to say, you know, I respect the lineage of the show, but I also am an actor doing a job playing a different incarnation of this role. When it comes to like James Bond's, like maybe James Bond's a bad example because that is culturally like ubiquitous and it's been going around for decades. It's got a comparable legacy to Doctor Who, but the barrier to entry is significantly lower. Like the canon kind of resets with every James Bond incarnation, and there's also only like 20-ish films where there's like now for Doctor Who, there's like nearly 40 seasons, a movie, multiple movies, I should say, and it's so thoroughly complex and contradictory. Like, I do not want an actor who, let's say, for example, Vicky McClure, I do not want an actor to be offered the role of the lifetime, to be offered the role of Doctor Who, and then they're like, actually, I need to research 50 to 60 years of the show because of some arbitrary standard. I think that would be hugely limiting and gatekeepery. And I think a lot of people who do ask this question, they ask this question because they do their fan shows and they do their fan series and their fan adaptations, which are awesome and cool, but they do those because they're super fans. I do not think that the Doctor should only be played by super fans. I think that the world is too big, the acting community is too vast and diverse and interesting to just limit the casting of this show to just a bit of an arbitrary standard. Christian Rowley says, what research would Jodie need to do in terms of canon anyway? Does she need to be able to name every alien planet or that's ever been on the show? Once again, it is a case of just like, what does it mean to be a fan? What is research? Because if you consider research to just be like going on TARDIS Wiki for like 2 months before auditioning, like that's, in my opinion, for that particular role, like that's a good bit of research to do if you're a script editor, or a good bit of research to do if you're a production designer wanting to emulate, for example, like a Cyberman design, or you, let's say that the series 13, you go to Telos and it's like, okay, what did Telos look like in the classic series? Oh, Telos in Tomb of the Cybermen and Telos in Attack of the Cybermen look completely different. It's often contradictory when it comes to like James Bond as well. What is sort of the lineage here? I think as the demographics of a country and as a community change over the like past several decades as well, you may have women and also people of colour as well who did not grow up with the classic series. Should they just be shut out because they haven't done appropriate quote-unquote research for the show? It does read as just gatekeepy. And if you do, honestly and earnestly, hearts on hearts of hearts, actually hold the opinion that the Doctor should only be played by a fan, a super fan, someone who does their research on the show, things like that, someone who 100% respects the show before getting into it, and by respect the show, like, has memorized every detail about it. If you honestly, earnestly hold that position, okay, fair enough, but do you also hold that standard to Jon Pertwee? Do you also hold that standard to Sylvester McCoy? Do you also hold that standard to Christopher Eccleston? Do you also hold that standard to Matt Smith? And if you only hold the standards to Jodie Whittaker exclusively, what's the ulterior motive here? Callum Stack says, yeah, it's pretty telling when it only gets brought up with Jodie. Yeah, because like I said, I've only ever seen this conversation happen in the context of Jodie Whittaker's a bad doctor. I've never seen this applied to any other context. It does seem like the chat agrees with me. I do feel like I'm kind of preaching to the choir here. Doctor Who's Magical Entertainment says the showrunner picks the doctor's actor. Yeah, the showrunner will, I imagine the BBC will have some say in it. Because when you're the doctor as well, there's so much beyond the role that is required than just when you turn up on set. There is like, and Agent Woodhead even brings this up as well. What do I think of Jodie Whittaker as an overall ambassador? I'm in two minds about it. I think Jodie Whittaker, when she has been allowed to showcase herself and her talent and her performance, I do think that she's been a terrific like advocate for the show. Like her charity appearances, her like in-person appearances and her messages to the fandom, those videos, like when she's in the cupboard at the beginning of the lockdowns and stuff. Like, I think she's been a terrific advocate for the show. However, as Aidan Woodhead points out, seeing people online saying she does not put enough effort for the fans, I do think that she has been like put on, like, lack of a better term, like a leash by the BBC because there's so little marketing for the era, because they do so few press junkets, because they do so few interviews. Like, they hardly do anything for Doctor Who magazine. They don't really do any other behind the scenes stuff. It's so limiting in terms of making Jodie Whittaker a face for the show. because like, even when John Bishop is like is let off set or is let off the TARDIS set for a morning to do something for BBC Breakfast, he can't talk about anything. Like Jodie Whittaker definitely can't talk about anything. She can't promote the show because they have such a secretive policy. It feels like Jodie Whittaker is caught between a rock and a hard place. Like, you know, I'm sure she would love to like talk about the show. I'm sure that she would love to be more present and more public. But the BBC are like, no, or maybe Chibnall, I don't know. This is one reason I really want to know about the behind-the-scenes stuff. This is why I really want to know whose idea is this secrecy policy. And I think the unintentional consequence of that secrecy policy is that it leaves Jodie Whittaker outside of the 6 to 8 to 10 weeks that Doctor Who is on the air, leaves her with very little to do. Brandywine88 says, should the showrunner be a superfan, though? That's the interesting question. I think that is the more legitimate conversation to be having. Because I think when it comes to playing an actor, you've got your own processes. But when you're a showrunner, you are significantly more creatively involved. I think that having a fan, and once again, we get into arbitrary definitions of what a fan is. But when it comes to being a fan of the show, I think it really helps to have someone on board who knows like the history of the show. I think there should be someone on the creative team who can read a script and be like, okay, this story treatment you've given me is basically exactly what happened in the Sontaran experiment. I think that this is something that Big Finish have done, although I don't think that should necessarily limit you. I think that there should be somebody behind the scenes that, you know, can fact check, but even then, canon is what on earth is canon? And if I don't think you should creatively limit yourself into telling an interesting story because a missing story from the 1960s also did it. I think that should kind of be, you know, a little in the back of your mind. I don't think it should be the driving factor, but in terms of the actual showrunner proper, I don't think so. I don't think they need to be a fan either. I think that, once again, it's gatekeepery. I think you can get big fans of the show, like Mike Flanagan. I think Mike Flanagan is a big fan of Doctor Who, and that's great. You know, if a fan gets involved in the show, absolutely, that's really cool. But I don't know if Sally Wainwright is a show. Like, also, like, how do you means test this? Like, Sally Wainwright is not someone, I believe, who has a big social media presence. Like, she doesn't tweet about anything, let alone Doctor Who. Like, she could already be a fan. I don't know. I imagine if you're a TV writer, you kind of are still watching other TV shows to find out, you know, where the pulse is on the industry, things like that. But like, let's say for the sake of argument that Sally Wainwright is not a Doctor Who fan. I think as long as like Sally Wainwright is like knows what to do in terms of like creative storytelling and telling profound, interesting stories with well-rounded, richly detailed characters, all you need to do is kind of apply that to a sci-fi setting to an extent. Once again, like let the creative process play out, because I think so many people who have this argument and have this discussion, they say that they want sort of free expression for creatives and they don't want people to be limited by fan. They're like, oh, don't like let cast this person, write this story, do whatever, don't let cancel culture, you know, influence you. And then when it turns out that they're telling stories that they ideologically don't like, they're like, no, cancel it, you know. The ideological framework for them is just not there. Adcratone May says, politics and media is bad unless I agree. This is, unironically, what many people believe. I think that there's something to be said for a writer's room process, but that doesn't really happen in the UK because the budgets are not nearly as high as they are in the US. Where you can have, like, the non-fan who's the showrunner, the fan who's the script editor, things like... Oh, also, one thing that's many people kind of forget is that Andrew Cartmell, considered to be one of the best Doctor Who creatives who helped kind of spearhead the Sylvester McCoy era and everything and produced some of the best stories of the 1980s, or who was behind some of the best stories of the 1980s, was not a fan of Doctor Who. He'd not watched it before. Yet he comes along for the Sylvester McCoy era, and he helps to script edit incredible stories like Remembrance of the Daleks, like The Happiness Patrol, like Survival, stories like that, Curse of Fenric. You know, Andrew Cartmell was not a fan of Doctor Who, and yet he was still able to celebrate the canon of the show. He was still able to celebrate the legacy of the show. Oh, Harry McHugh, have you read Script Doctor, Andrew Catmull's book? 2 seconds. My dude, I have a signed copy. Ha ha.